And once I see more and more and more programs that are indiscriminate and broadly based, I realize that our surveillance programs operate on the basis of the same principles as the worst governments on Earth, because they are not controlled most strongly by law or by policy, as by possibility.
You know the outcome and you see the journey.
A new world order.
This whole conspiracy to enslave humanity is a psychological game. You're not going to sell a tyranny by telling people it's a tyranny. The outcome is that they want to connect the human brain to artificial intelligence, so artificial intelligence becomes human consciousness.
So what I would like to talk to you a little bit about today is something I was asked to do in 2010 and 2011. I was getting ready to leave over at the CIA, where I'd worked for a number of years, and the Intelligence Science Board said, could you give us a brief on what's in store for us in the future? And it was some information I think some people didn't know, and I think it's good for people to be aware of what's going on out there. Can you actually send and receive sensory information, like the Matrix? The short answer is yes. What we do know is that DARPA did get permission for 500 operations to do deep brain electrode implants. They haven't published anything yet, but my guess is what you're looking at is human-human thought transference, and certainly in the open science world, that was published last month, actually, the brain-to-brain transfer of sensory information in two humans, and they achieved a success rate of being right 85% of the time. So you can attach one human brain to a device. You can attach the human brain to another human brain. You can direct motor activity, or you can send communication and information. So that's what people are doing. There's a whole world out there of biohacking. I don't know if you're aware of it, but you should be. So normally at the university, we are well regulated by the federal laws about studying and experimenting on humans. There's a biohacking community that is not part of the official science community that is busy trying to attach hardware to humans, and they do it in their basements. They study up on how to do the surgeries, how to connect devices, how to put motherboards in people. And they may use it for some purposes, like phishing, using RFID signals in their hands to take information from you. But there are some other interesting developments. When you start thinking about the fluidity of what you can do with the brain, they're experimenting with CE6 and giving people with eye drops night vision. For several hours, a person receiving the night drops can see over 160 feet in the dark. So it's a lot easier to look through your own eyes than it is to put on nods. And it will be a short time before you get a better solution than we get from the biohacking community, but it could also be readily available to almost anybody on the planet. It's going to be harder to keep this under control than it is to keep the special lenses and night vision technology. I think it's really important that people pay attention to this kind of a thing, because that can give humans the natural ability for a while to see in the dark. So people are playing with chemicals to enhance the human capacity. They're also experimenting now with how do you add a device to the mammalian brain to give it an extrasensory ability. You may not want to detect infrared. You might want to have a room temperature detector of radiation, depending on what your job is in life. So when you think about it, the possibility now is there to develop different kinds of devices. They could be perhaps used either by intelligence people or by people in the military to have an extra ability to be able to see through walls, to see heartbeats. We used to play with the 18 gigahertz microwave detectors, where we could pick up heartbeats through anything but solid steel and water, but that could easily be a human who can see the unique heartbeat that's behind the wall over there that's thermal insensitive. So it doesn't have to be IR. It can be a number of things. Anything that you can co-opt is theoretically now possible to adapt to human brain functioning. All you'd have to learn is the code. You'd have to train with it, It might not be natural at first. You might not understand the signal you're getting, but you can add to human brain function. The second field that people may or may not be aware of I always tell my students, I said I wasn't around when they developed atomic weapons, but Dr. Ventnor's work is, my view, the equivalent of the development of nuclear weapons when you realize that he created life in a cell back in 2010. I don't know if people are familiar with his work, but this technology paired with something called CRISPR, which is like an editing software for genes, makes a number of things immediately available. What he did is he programmed yeast cells to produce anything he wanted. They can produce perfume, they can produce petroleum, they can produce any peptide, anything we program the DNA to do, and it's in the living cell. Right, so in medicine, the goal in medicine now is to be able to do designer medicine and therapy. If we can design a cell to get into your body and release the right product for you, you won't be losing half the drugs you take through your liver when you swallow a pill and it gets digested. These can be inserted into you through the hypospray needles, almost like Dr. McCoy on Star Trek, giving you the hyperspray. It just blasts now plasmids into your squamous cells. But Ventnor was able to do that and has the patent on the technology. But you can engineer anything. You put in a specific gene slicing, you program what you like, you put it in the cell, and it can reproduce and make as much as you like. For those of you who don't know, your DNA is usually all wrapped up in tight little coils. And so what you were doing was, when they create plasmids and put them into cells, it sends a signal and tells which portion of the DNA should unwrap, unfold, and produce a product. Now, this is the future of medicine. When you look at this technology in medicine, say, this is going to be done to help people, right? We want to be able to give them medicines. We actually want to correct for genetic deficits. If a kid's born with a genetic anomaly, with the CRISPR technology, the feeling is we can create the portion of the gene they're missing and go have it spliced back in. And that may help a child, either if it's in utero development or once they're older, to have the missing substance actively produced. What would you do with this if you were in security and intelligence? Well, you can do a number of things. You could decide, if you make this gene, we know that certain people in the world who function at very high altitudes very, very well do it because they had a special mutation in their genome that we don't have because we didn't grow up in the Himalayas. But they can function at very high altitudes. Could you give this to people who are going to have to do war fighting in high altitudes and they don't require extra support? Their body makes a much more efficient use and can work under conditions of lower oxygen than the rest of us. You start letting your mind wander. Can it also produce a substance that lets you function longer underwater without oxygen? So, but these are run by certain mutations in genes, and with CRISPR we have the ability to actually make these and see what happens when we give them to animals, non-human or human animals, that don't have it naturally. You have the Forrest Gump gene. You guys have been tracking. There's a gene that just makes you stronger. Related to this is an idea called DREADs. These are designer receptors that can be remotely controlled. So think about it for a moment. You can create a designer receptor, you can create a cell, you can put it somewhere in the body, and you can remotely activate it when the brain's exposed to the right signal. Using this technology, people have been able to transfer memories from one fruit fly to another by signaling through a light stimulus into the retina. Right now, in most animals, it's done by putting a substance into their body that will actually activate the neuron in the way that you want it. So you have the capacity to create any product. As long as you know the DNA sequence, you can insert it into a living system, and you can remotely control it. So in medicine, we think about how we do that to help people, how we do to repair deficits. Other people are going to think about how do they do it to expand possibilities. Now, one of the challenges that we have is that when you create a cell and you put it in somebody's body, you have to figure out where you want it. What if you want it in their brain? Right? If you want it in their brain and you can't figure out, you don't want to do surgery to plant it in their brain. If I want a product produced in your brain that may affect the way you think, the way you act. One route to that is through stem cells. If you're a quick brush up on your biology, stem cells are cells, they call them God cells. They can turn into anything. They hold the potential, unlike other cells in your body, to become anything you want them to become. And they can go find their home in the body and park there and do the work that you'd like them to do. You can infuse them and they will find their way into the brain. So once you know that the technology is there to edit, splice, and program a cell, and the technology currently exists to administer it to somebody and have it go park anywhere you program it to go park, proliferate, and do its function, you can have things activated in other people's brains.
Again, it's so funny because the military contacted me and asked if I would help them. And I'm reluctant to do that because I like talking about everything. And it would be top secret, whatever they told me. So it's like, I don't know. I have a lot of ideas, but I don't want to know what you're doing because I only want to know what's public. So this is public. But how they're doing it is not public. But I will tell you, one of the things we'll be able to do is we'll be to outsource functions of our brain. So we'll be able to outsource, we'll be able to upload our memories to the cloud. What they're doing is looking at the pattern in the brain, and then they're matching that pattern, they're putting that into a database. So if you can match the patterns in somebody's brain to the patterns in the database, you can literally start to read their mind. Every time a word comes up, you know it. Oh, that word came up for that individual. Now, will the patterns be identical in every person? Probably not, though the information will be stored in slightly different places. But it wouldn't take long for you to train a machine to read your mind. Now, that's just the beginning. They may be able to have algorithms sophisticated enough, and they get enough samples, enough data, that the AI could actually learn over time what the general rules are for different words, and then you could apply it to anybody.
It's the Human Mind Project, the Global Brain Project. You know, President Obama just recently funded a whole bunch of scientists to decipher the mind. Well, our previous president, same thing, George Bush, said the same thing. They're trying to decipher every possible thought and uniqueness due to culture and language and whatnot.
So you can push your biosignals to the cloud through a few API calls. Then we have a large amount of sophisticated signal processing that's spun up to make sense of that data. And then with a few more lines of code through, again, a simple REST API, you can get back a meaningful result, and all that happening in real time.
It's a scary proposition to think that every biosignal from us will be one day measured, but if it is, I'd like to know that I'm in control of that data and not the NSA.
Oh, absolutely.
This deal would be a game changer for both the CIA and Amazon. Bloomberg reports the pairing would innovate new uses for cloud technology.
This level of technology could include brain-to-brain interfaces, brain-to-computer interfaces, and specifically brain-to-cloud interfaces. Technology linking the brain to the cloud could drastically alter the state of communications between humans and machines. The senior author of the study noted that once inside the brain, the devices would then wirelessly transmit and encoded information to and from a cloud-based supercomputer network for real-time brain state monitoring and data extraction.
Essentially, the CIA is attempting to use artificial intelligence, AI, and that's where all the focus, by the way, of these tech companies is right now, is into artificial intelligence to really control the population. And I know it sounds so Orwellian, it sounds science fiction even to say these things, and yet that has been the primary focus of companies like Amazon over the last few years.
This deal would be a game changer for both the CIA and Amazon. Bloomberg reports the pairing would innovate new uses for cloud technology.
It refers to using the cloud computing technology in a company's own data center
Because you know, Amazon is better known for these public clouds where the hardware is shared with other users.
The CIA has refused to comment on the deal, saying it doesn't publicly disclose details on its contracts. Amazon wouldn't talk either, and CNET's Charles Cooper says neither party probably ever will. Given how Amazon usually considers everything, including the state of the current weather in Seattle, as something of a state secret, odds are we'll never hear much more.
I became a security specialist for SIS, specializing in executive protection, also risk and threat assessment to our clients. Our clients are the companies or the individuals that we contract out with and provide services for. And it was in that context that I became aware of what I describe as a social engineering program and a research and development program that was being carried out by SIS and our clients in Seattle, the Amazon Corporation. And I later learned that they were indeed experimenting with, when I say experimenting, voice-to-skull, hive mind, behavior modification technology that is frequency-based and directed at a targeted individual to basically control their entire person. Once you have connected the targeted individual with the frequency and they resonate together, then you have a perfect avenue upon which to send and receive information back and forth. And that's exactly how they manipulate someone's thoughts. They send voices into someone's head. They manipulate their emotions. They manipulate their behavior. And then that's also how they receive back from the individual in real time the vital signs, the emotions, the thoughts, what the person's seeing, what the person's hearing. And then all that information, of course, is rendered on a computer elsewhere via software, and it can be monitored and tracked in real time.
Once we tap into the brain, if we have algorithms that stimulate the right things and give it the right data, we could literally see a screen pop up. We call it hallucinating, right? But these would be controlled hallucinations run by algorithms that would give us everything AR would without any glasses.
This technology can be used to beam images and even motion pictures into one's brain. Images and motion pictures that are so realistic that you think you're actually watching a movie or seeing something in reality. It's like a virtual reality 3D rendering that takes place within the target's mind.
Biological knowledge multiplied by computing power, multiplied by data, equals the ability to hack humans. And the AI revolution or crisis is not just AI, it's also biology, it's biotech.
The Brain Initiative is a $6 billion fund to find new ways to map the activity of an entire brain. Leading neuroscientist Professor Raphael Yuste was at the front of the queue for funding.
We're not talking about data privacy. This is much worse. We're talking about the contents of your mind.
And maybe I'll explain what it means, the ability to hack humans, to create an algorithm that understands me better than I understand myself and can therefore manipulate me, enhance me, or replace me.
The goal of the Brain Initiative is precisely to build methods to read and manipulate the activity of neural circuits.
We call it hallucinating, right? But these would be controlled hallucinations run by algorithms.
So that when that person goes to speak out about it, when they go to seek help from their fellow human beings, and their fellow human beings say, "What is it that's happening to you?" The target will then say, "I'm hearing voices inside my head."
But these would be controlled hallucinations run by algorithms.
And they will conclude that this person must be crazy. And as a result, they will recommend psychological evaluation for that person. You can see the way this is going to go and the way it is going right now. As good people, helpless people that are being abused and tortured and enslaved and experimented upon in America today, American citizens cry out for help from their fellow Americans. And their fellow Americans say, "Why don't you take some Prozac? Because we think you're schizophrenic." Well, this is a highly technical program. All of the symptoms are induced by a technology that is so fucking sophisticated, it is horrifying beyond description.
It can literally stop your own thoughts from happening and replace them with other thoughts by sending thoughts to your head. And it's so sophisticated that you cannot tell where these thoughts are coming from. There's no way to discern that they are coming from somewhere other than your own mind. So you can imagine how bad this would be for people that don't even realize this technology exists. And they're having these thoughts, which they think are spontaneous, because being under the influence of this technology now, kind of having been on both sides of it, I am just amazed at the way it works. And I know that the thoughts that they beam into your head originate from the exact same place in your mind that your own natural thoughts originate from. So if I didn't know I was under the influence of this technology, then I would have no idea that anyone was influencing my thoughts at all.
So these are people within our government at a certain level making these decisions, and they're not necessarily our president or our elected officials.
That's exactly right.
Wow. That makes it even more difficult because they can't be removed.
They can't be removed, and they're difficult to find.
He thought that they would value the principles in the Constitution, what they stood for in terms of human rights and human freedom. But they don't apparently care for that. I mean, it's more it becomes an issue of money, control, and power. And it's not a question of human rights anymore. So if you're a target, there's virtually nothing you can do.
You worked for these people. You worked on this. You helped to develop it.
I was naive. I did not know how the technologies were going to be put together and the ultimate weapon created.
You're not still working for them.
No.
You're unequivocally looking me right in the eye right now, and you're telling me you have no more to do with this and that you're out to expose it?
That's correct, sir.
With your background and what you know, can you give us a hint on what we ought to do?
No.
No. Is it too late?
I actually believe it's too late.
So what you're telling me, every one of us should be in fear of this because every one of us at some point will be targeted?
The technology has advanced that far.
There is a very real risk that you are going to become a full-blown, 24/7 targeted individual. And this technology at that point, when it is nationwide, will be used by automated computer, supercomputer software programming that will manipulate the emotions and the behavior and the thoughts of everybody in the United States of America. And it can all be done remotely. It's very much like the microchip kind of tracking the New World Order, this entire, you know, control grid that's supposed to be rolled out against the American people someday. And I'm here to tell you that it's already here. There isn't going to come a day where there's troops in the streets and tanks rolling down your neighborhood and riot gear and all this stuff. We might have isolated incidents like that. It might get like that every once in a while, but the true control grid is this technology.